flesh till it's worn off. Then awake, you saints, to the Lord, watch from the beginning. Singing here in this church, you probably remember that, Charlie, yourself, back years ago. They used to sing it, and it's called "The Message of His Coming." I know if you ever got a thing. That is good. Amen. Well, I think I'm coming out of the woods. Sucked my brains out last night, and I'm still not too over bad this morning.
Prayer work.
We were down in Mitchell, Indiana, at the Brother Spears Church. And what a wonderful service we had down there. I love the Spears, and that man's 72, and I tell you, he's a ball of fire. It's really something.
And I tell you what, he reached your heart out.
He can really sing, and poor old Julie was just ringing with when she got done, buddy. But it was good. It was really good. But it's going to be in our church today.
Amen.
Let's all look to the Lord right now. Father, we love you today. We are thankful for your love and your mercy. Oh God, how good it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. Bless us, oh God, together. Lift us together. Open our hearts and minds. Hallelujah. Teach us thy ways and truth. Make this a house of worship, oh Father. We thank you for it, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, may you had problems, maybe things are not perfect in your world today, too. But just give it all to Jesus today. You might as well.
Might as well.
He's the one in charge, and he's going to take care.
Amen.
He always has, and I believe he always will. And so let's come together and begin to sing and worship him. Lift him up. Lay your problems aside. Get your mind upon the Lord. And let him enter in and bless us today.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. All right, Sister Judy is here. Boy, she's worked hard this week.
Oh,
about him, Ronnie. He's old.
He's quick, he can't read.
God is so good. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
That's right.
Oh, I don't know about that.
Not a bunch of wisemakers, did you?
Thank you, honey.
You know, it's really hard to get your mind straight when you've got such antics going. Poor Sister June, I don't know how you do it, Effie. Oh, I do thank God today. I praise Him for His mercy and grace. And I praise Him for the revival that we had.
Yeah.
Excuse me, if you missed it, you missed it. It was so absolutely wonderful. The Spirit of the Lord was just everywhere. He just... I mean, you could not be in this room, in this building. I don't even think you could drive down the road without feeling a little something. It was so absolutely wonderful. It was just really, and it's just strange how God works, you know, because I work sometimes, you know, my kids don't get gone until 5:30, 6 o'clock, and then by the time you get things done, and the first night I just came in the clothes I wore all day long, you know, I was all scruffy, and it's like, oh well, I'm going to get there, I'm going to make it, I'll be there, and show, and I'm thinking, oh really, please, whatever, you don't call me up there to sing. I do not want to get up there in front of these people looking like this. And I'm telling you, the Spirit hit me, and I was just all making a spectacle of myself. It was horrible. And I thought, the time that you just don't want it. You don't want anybody to even know you're in the building. God says, oh, well, here you go. But you know, it didn't matter. It didn't matter because the Spirit of the Lord was so good, so good. It was wonderful. He is just absolutely, it's like Brother Pat said, you know, Sister Phyllis was saying how there was time, you know, when she would get her hair all fixed and everything looked. It was so strange that she was saying that had to have a certain look, and she'd just get hair down, she'd be in all matted mess, and she didn't care. You know, she went in, you know, and all she wanted was God to have His way,
amen.
And that's truly
amen.
What I want God to have His way in my life, today and always. If you could please lift your hands this morning and just give God honor and glory. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus, mighty God. Lord, we come unto you this day, Lord. We ask that you would send us your anointing. Open our ears, Lord God. Open our hearts. Help us, Lord Jesus, that we might receive the word today, Lord God. That we might hear the word. And that word would be written upon the tables of our hearts, Lord God. Oh, Lord, that it would be hidden, Lord God, in the secret chamber, Lord God. That at whatever time and point that we are in need, Lord God, that word would come forth. You said, open your mouth and I will fill it. Lord, plant that word deep within our heart, deep within our mind, deep within our spirit, Lord, that it would be available to us, Lord God, that it might encourage us and enrich us and help us, Lord God, to witness to those round about us. Truly, I thank you today, Lord Jesus, and I praise you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Amen.
Oh, yes, thank you, Jesus. You know, I've been thinking about this scripture. Actually, I've got the yawn today. Excuse me.
Oh, you'll get the whole church doing that.
I know, that's so bad.
All right. You may do that up here.
They say it's lack of oxygen, so yes. What can I say? My brain would tell you it's definitely lack of oxygen. But I've been thinking about this scripture about the woman with the issue of blood for a week now. And generally, you know, I don't, even God doesn't really do it with me until the day before, only because He knows my mind is so. Thank you so very much.
Run wrong with you.
Amen.
But I was thinking about this scripture, and the thing that impressed on me so, that God really had impressed on me so very much, was the fact that for 12 years, 14 years, I can't
12.
Remember,
12, 14, right.
12 she had sought many doctors. She had spent all of her income. She had spent everything she had. She'd done everything that the world had told her to do. To take care of it, but all it actually took was one touch from God.
Amen.
How many times do we search everywhere in this world for an answer?
Amen.
And then when we finally stop and say, okay, God, I give up. Mm-hmm. I'm done. I can't do anymore. It is totally in your hands.
I know.
You have to take care of it. Mm-hmm. Immediately, it's taken care of. He just does. And we go, I don't understand. I've tried and tried and tried and tried. And seemingly could get nowhere. And all I had to do was turn it over to God, and He just took care of it.
Amen.
So much of the time, we want to take care of things ourselves. I don't know about you, but I know in my family, we like to just take care of it, get it done, take care of it. That's just the way it is. And you know, sometimes God says, just back off this, leave this alone. And you know, and we'll be real good. I can tell you personally in situations, I said, I'm done, Lord. I can't do anymore. This is it. You're just going to have to take care of it. Here it is. It's yours. I'm done with it. I'm walking away. Whatever happens, happens. I'm done. And then I'll walk off. And next thing I know, God is just working things out. And He's taking care of things. And it's looking really good. And then I say, oh, well, maybe I ought to.
Yeah, let me pick over.
You've done such a good job so far. I'm sure I can finish it up. And then I'm right back in the same turmoil and the same problem. It's here. I don't know about you, but most of my trouble is right here.
Yeah.
It's in my heart. It's in my mind. And it comes out of my mouth. You know, what is it James says? This is the smallest member, the hardest thing to tame. This little teeny tiny tongue of ours. I mean, you know,
helping Jesus.
The smallest thing, and yet we can't control it. Just don't seem right, does it? Sorry.
Well, it's hard sometimes.
But I want you to understand, it all comes from right here.
That's right.
From the heart.
What comes out of here
is what precedes out
starts of right here. What comes out of here starts right here. Right here is where it starts. Because the enemy will come and he will plant that root of bitterness. I mean, face it. Mm-hmm. A mustard seed and was it Brother Mark was talking about the mustard seed the other day? And how it's so tiny. Mm-hmm. A mustard seed is so tiny.
Smallest seed there is.
And you put it in the ground, and it's like, wow. And before you know it, I mean, it is overwhelming. It's consuming the way that it will spread. And that's the way a root of bitterness will do inside of us. Do you understand that? That little tiny, tiny seed that's planted. Now, you can pray and ask God to deliver you, and He will just rip it right out. Or you can cultivate it. You can cultivate that bitterness. It's like, oh, well, let's put a little anger on here. Yeah, let's get the anger in there. Oh, let's get a little judgment right in here. Okay, we'll put this judgment here. I know exactly. A little lie here. I mean, let's just cultivate this bitterness. Let's just make that bitterness grow bigger and bigger. Instead of going to God and saying, let's just rip this out and get rid of it. You know, we don't want to rip it out. We want to cultivate it. But you just don't know what I've been through. You just don't understand. Let's make it grow a little bit bigger. Before you know, it is so overwhelmingly consuming, you can't see anything because bitterness has obstructed your vision. Bitterness has overcome everything. Bitterness is all you can see. God does not want that.
No.
When that little teeny tiny seed of bitterness is planted, the first thing you do is you got to pray. I mean, the Word of God is like, it's like a pesticide, man. I mean, it goes right in, just kills that bitterness out, tosses it around.
Yeah.
Amen.
And you can do one of two things. When you have that root of bitterness beginning to grow, you can seek God and ask God to come in, and He will quench that and take it out. Or you can just go get the Miracle-Gro and pour on that Miracle-Gro, man. And pretty soon, it's just flourishing and looks like...
We're in the business.
And if you think people do not know it's there, I've had people come to me and say, what is going on in your... You're just not the same.
Better old woman.
I mean, I've certainly... Because I'm generally not snappy. I'm generally not a snappy person, but when I let that root of bitterness get in and start taking over, I begin to get a little bit snappy. I'm not telling you again to pick that up. I am generally not snappy. Do you hear that? I am not snappy. I try extremely hard to be as patient as I can, because when you have children, you have to be patient. That's all there's to it. But I can tell when I've allowed that bitterness to come in and begin to grow, because it changes the way you see things, it changes the way you feel about things, and it definitely changes the way you speak about things.
Maybe it's your whole life.
Now, when you know that that root of bitterness is there and it's coming in, it's growing, it's like this woman with the issue of blood. Do you understand? She had it for year after year after year, and she done everything the world told her to do. Do you understand that?
Amen.
She went to the doctor. She probably had experimental medications. They probably had her standing on her head. Who knows what they had this poor woman doing to try to stop the blood from flowing. She did everything. And just like Brother Mark said, when the world, when the money stops, the assistance stops. I mean, you know, you go to the doctor and they say, well, I think you're depressed. That's it. I'm telling you, every time I've ever been to the doctor for anything, the first thing they say is, are you depressed?
Yeah.
I'm sick. I mean, yeah. I mean, when you have pain, you cannot have depression you cannot have some type of depression if you're having pain. If your body is physically hurting, of course you're going to have depression. It's just part of it. You can't help it. You're not going to go around happy. Oh, my back hurts so bad, I just can't stand it. When you have intense pain, of course you're going to have a certain amount of depression. It happened. How can you not have?
That's right. Amen. That's right.
But you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Sister Wilson, you say, I got this pain, that pain. I said, Sister Wilson, you're 90 years old. I mean, I'm a lot younger than you.
But you press on past it, do you not?
Yeah.
You have to press on past it. You can't allow those things to come in and overtake you. She did everything she could do in the world. She went to every doctor. She did, I'm sure, every experimental thing that they tried on her. And Lord knows what they tried back then. It wasn't like they had 10 years of studies as to whether or not this is going to work and what the complications are going to be and how many people are we going to be willing to die just in order to help this. I mean, it's like, hey, try this root of John Jones. We'll see how this helps. It's like, hey, you know what? Leeches really do work.
I guess they do.
They use leeches on burn victims because it really, they do use leeches in many different things.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It really did work.
Well, they say leecher. Leecher. Yeah.
It's hard to tell what they did to this poor woman. She tried everything. She did everything she was told to do. And she couldn't do anything else. All right, my money's gone. I'm going to die. I've got to do something. And it's one day somebody came to her and said, hey, you know what? You know, I heard about this man named Jesus.
Oh, hallelujah.
And you would not believe the most miraculous thing. I mean, he has actually opened the eyes of blinded people. People who were blind all of a sudden they can see again. People who were deaf can hear. People who were totally, half their bodies were consumed with leprosy. Parts of their bodies was missing because leprosy literally ate the meat and skin off of their body. There was these group of 10 guys and they went and Jesus said, go and do this. And their bodies were healed and they came back and said, look, I'm whole.
Oh,
he didn't do it halfway.
No.
Look, I'm whole, I'm completely whole. Look, I've got 10 fingers.
Yeah.
Remember when I had 6.5? Now I've got 10 fingers. Remember when I only had 2 toes on this foot?
Yeah.
Woohoo! I've got 5.
Amen.
Because there was this man named Jesus.
Hallelujah.
And he told me what to do, and I did it. And I'm completely and totally healed. She heard the testimonies of the people who had been touched by his ministry.
Yes.
She heard the stories of the people who had been healed and who had been changed. And she heard about a man named Peter who was a cantankerous fisherman. Man, he was something else, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Rough as a cob, my land. But something happened. And now this Peter is following along behind this man, Jesus.
Unreal.
Hey, did you know that Matthew, that tax collector, you know, the guy that kept ripping us off every year? Every year he'd not only take their share, but his share and our share and everybody's share. Remember Matthew? Remember the tax collector?
He got religion.
Wow. He's following this man, Jesus.
Yeah.
Something changed. Something changed. I'm telling you, there's something about this guy. There's something about this guy. He's making miraculous changes in people's lives. And guess what? He's coming to town. I heard he got off a boat over on such and such beach, and he's headed to town. And she's like, what else do I have nothing to lose. If I, in her head, understand, in her mind she said, I know that he is so mighty and so powerful. If I can just get close enough to touch his clothes, if I can just get a hold of the hem of his garment, if I can just touch his clothes, he doesn't even have to know anything about it. He doesn't even have to pray for me. All he has to do is just be where I can touch him. Because if I touch him, something's going to change. And you imagine her disappointment when she got there. And there were hundreds and hundreds and thousands of people. And the thing is that he was on a mission already. He was on a mission. Jairus had came to him and said, my daughter is so sick. She is near death. I need you to come to my home. I need you to come to my home and I need you to come and pray. She is so sick. We don't know what else to do. And Jesus said, come on. So he gathered them together and they're walking down the road. And not only had she heard, but many people had heard.
Sure.
And they'd all come out to see this Jesus, this miracle man, this guy that can walk on the water, this man that can put the flesh back on the bone, this man that opened the blinded eye. Oh, they all come to see him.
Yes, amen.
Oh, yes.
And can you imagine when she came to the street and thought, oh, my, look at all those people.
No,
I've got to get to him.
Amen.
Somehow I've got to get to them.
Hallelujah.
And I truly believe
Hallelujah.
That she started out, excuse me.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
Excuse me.
Excuse me.
until she touched the hem of his garment.
Amen.
And when she touched the hem of his garment,
hallelujah.
When she touched the hem of his garment, immediately. Immediately.
What was she doing?
Put it on camera, Jerry.
Immediately, she said.
Yes, I'm sure she did. Oh, take a breath.
Oh, something's different. Oh.
Hallelujah.
Her strength came back into her body. Because I don't know about you, Brother Ronnie.
Yes.
When you lost your blood, when the blood was coming out, how did you feel in the morning when you got up?
Didn't want to get up.
Were you tired? Well, just the thought of getting up to go in the kitchen to get something to drink? You're like, man, is it really worth it?
It was bad.
There was no strength in her until she touched the hem of his garment. And the moment she touched the hem of his garment, strength came into her. And at the same time, virtue flowed out of Christ.
Yes, he knew.
It was like sticking your finger in a light socket.
Oh, I bet it was.
Woo-hoo! Could she feel it? And he felt it. And immediately he turns around and he says, "Who touched me?"
Yeah. Well.
And his disciples are going,
"Okay."
Who touched you? There's 100 people around you. They're all touching you. But see, they were all touching him.
But
somebody touched
him.
Touching him.
They were all standing around going, "That Jesus. Yeah,
my old pal.
He's my friend. That's my bud. We're cool, we're tight, man. That's my Jesus. But you know what? They really didn't need him. They really didn't want to change. They really didn't want a miracle.
That's right.
Amen.
She not only wanted it and needed it, but she had to have it. She had to have it.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
And when she touched him, that point of contact made a change. And he immediately said, "Who touched me?" And they said, "What do you mean, who touched you?" And he said, "You don't understand. I perceive someone, because virtue has went out of me. Something has happened for someone. Someone has changed. There's something different." And even though she was afraid, because she didn't know, she was a woman. You have to understand, she was a woman. And in that time and in that country, you did not touch a man's body. You did not lay hold on a man. And she said, "It was me. It was me." And he said, "Oh, my faith has made
me whole."
He didn't say, "Go home, call the doctor, take 2 aspirin." No, you know what he said? "Thy faith
has made me whole."
Amen.
And whole means complete.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Complete.
Amen.
You are complete. And I believe that from that day forward, not only was her physical body changed.
Oh, her spiritual.
But her spiritual mind was changed.
Faith.
She needed a change, and she got it.
She got it.
And then here's Jairus standing on the wayside here saying, "My daughter's dying, my daughter." How many of you have ever been in a hurry to get somewhere because you knew it was desperate that you get there? Someone was sick and they said they're not going to make it, you've got to get there. And in your heart you're just like, "Just let me get there, please, just let me get there, just let me get there, just let me get there." Can you imagine in his heart? I'm sure he was happy that the woman was healed, but in his mind it's, "Come on, please, my daughter is dying. You've got to get there. Oh, come on. And I'm sure he's not saying anything, but in his heart he's like, "Oh, come on. I need this answer now." And then someone walks up and says,
don't worry. Don't bother the master. She's dead. Mm-hmm. It's too late. It's too late. Yeah. And he could have gotten mad and angry and said, it's your fault. It's all your fault. If you had just not detained him, if you'd have just waited a little bit longer, my daughter would still be alive. It's all your fault. And he could have allowed a root of bitterness to come in, and he could have walked off and said, my daughter's dead just because of that woman. It's her fault. It's not my fault that they didn't heal her 12 years ago. Now look, now my daughter is dead, and it's all her fault. He could have gotten himself, and he could have walked off, sure. And that bitterness could have grown and grown and grown and grown and consumed him. And when he got home, his daughter would have been dead. Do you understand that?
Mm-hmm.
She would have been dead. But when they came and they said, your daughter's dead, there's no hope. And oh, his heart. But Jesus turned to him and said, don't fear. Don't be afraid. She's not dead. She's not dead. It's going to be okay. How many times have we been in a situation where it seemed absolutely impossible? And the world is telling you, give it up. There's no hope. They can't help you. There's nothing they can do. There is nothing they can do. You might as well just forget it. I mean, you've been going through this now for 20 years, year after year after year after year. Why don't you just give up? Why don't you just walk off and leave it?
Curse God and die.
Curse God and die. That's what Job's wife said.
Uh-huh. Isn't that easy?
That's what she said.
Do you still retain your integrity? Do you still retain your integrity? Why don't you just curse God and die?
Well, when you speak like a fool.
The world will tell you there's no hope. There's no hope. That baby's been born with heart damage and brain damage, and there's no hope. There isn't anything we can do. Our grandson, Justin, when Jenny was pregnant with him, when she first got pregnant, they were really, really concerned because she had some physical problems. And they said, we're going to have to keep a close eye on her. Well, at about 5 months, they started doing ultrasounds, and they said that she had too much amniotic fluid, which meant the baby was either going to be born without a brain, or it was going to be born with multiple disabilities. And for the whole 4 months, every time she'd go back, they would say, at first they wanted her to consider the outcome. You need to really consider the outcome. Do you think that, are you willing to deal with a child with all of these disabilities? Because, abortion is very easy and will solve your problem. You don't have to worry about these. All of these things are always given to you as an option.
Sure.
Now, you have to understand. And it's not like they're saying, you might have some problems. They're looking at ultrasound, and they're showing her, this is your problem. This is what's going to happen. Well, we can't find his brain. They told her, we can't find his brain. You really need to consider. She said, no. And every month she would go back. She would go back. And then I remember the night that she went into delivery. They said, we're going to have to keep a really close eye because, most likely he's not going to live more than 2 hours after you give birth. So they're telling her all of these things, right? Well, she has this little baby boy, and he comes out, and I'm telling you, he is the cutest, the sweetest, the most perfectly normal little boy there is in the world. There is not a dinosaur. There's not a thing about a dinosaur that he can't take. He'd tell you every dinosaur what they do and how they do it, whether they're meat eaters or they're vegetarians, whether they fly. What year they was in? I mean, the kid is 5 years old. He's six. He turned six in December.
Then we'll try to take him out.
Child.
Yep, he's got a call.
Now they told her. This is what the test is telling us. There's no doubt. We know you must prepare yourself for this.
They don't know everything.
You have to prepare yourself for this. And we just kept saying, Jenny, honey, they don't know everything. They don't know everything.
No.
They do not know everything.
Yes, Mother.
And I'm not saying this and know everything doctors say, because
no.
They're practicing physicians.
Yeah.
That's it.
And they do the very best that they can. And I do think that it's good to listen and to weigh what they have to say.
Sure.
But I want you to know and understand, had she had an abortion, there would have been no other choice.
That's right.
Death is a permanent solution to a temporary problem.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I hear people say, I'm just going to kill myself. Well, that's a permanent solution.
Mm-hmm.
The problem you're going through really is temporary.
That's right.
Because God can change it.
It will match.
God can change it at any point in time. And so, you know, we watch him grow. We see him. His language is wonderful. He is so smart and precocious and a wonderful kid. And I think, had she not trusted, had we not sought God all the time, God is able to change all things. And just like with Jairus, when they came in and they said, don't trouble him, she's already gone. And what did Jesus say?
Jesus,
don't be troubled. It's okay. And then when he gets there to pray, they're saying, what you here for now, Jesus? She's already gone. You're too late. Again, you're too late. I think they said that about Lazarus, too, didn't they?
Yeah.
You're too late. If you had just been here 4 days ago, my brother would not have had to die. If you would have just been here when I called you, if you would have just done it when I wanted it done, if you would just do it my way, everything would be great.
Wrong.
You should do it my way, because my way is the right way. And Jesus goes, Jesus says, be not troubled. What did he do? In Lazarus' case, he walked out and he said, roll the stone away. And he called, Lazarus, come forth. The man was dead in the ground. But he did it as an example to show that nothing is out of his power.
Amen.
Do you understand?
Right, right.
Nothing is out of his power. And he walked into Jairus' daughter's house, and there she lay on the bed, lifeless, not moving, not breathing, dead as far as they were concerned. And Jesus comes in, they're like, you're too late, and they're all crying. Ah, 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 ah. They're distraught. They lost their child. The mother's sitting there, and her child is dead. What else are they going to do? They're angry. They're afraid. They're sorrowful. They're mourning. All these flood of emotions are coming in. And here comes Jesus, who was supposed to save the day, but he's too late. You're too late. And he said, I'm not too late. She's not dead. And they're like, listen, she's got no heartbeat. She's got no breath in her body. She's dead. And he says, she's not dead. She's just asleep. She's just asleep.
Hallelujah.
And so they're like, oh, I just do not. And he says, leave. Just leave the room. If you cannot believe, just leave the room.
That's right.
Them all out.
Just leave the room. And he kept the mom, the dad, Peter, John, and James. Why? Because he wanted believers around him.
Amen.
Right.
He knew those three would believe no matter what it looked like.
Right.
And the mom and dad needed to be there so they might see the miracle of God.
Right.
He wanted them to see your child who was dead is now alive. And it isn't because we brought in some magic potion and poured it down her throat. It's because Jesus simply laid his hand on her hand. Laid her hand in his. And said, arise, come on up a little higher. Come on up out of that deep place that you're in. Come on up out of that deep, dark place you're in. Come on up out of death. Come on up out of bitterness. Come on up out of sorrow. Come on up out of mourning. Come on up. Took her by the hand and said, come on.
Arise.
And she stood to her feet. She stood to her feet and began to walk. And the mother saw, and I can imagine the joy in the mother, and the joy in the father. Here the father has just seen a miracle on his way, and now he sees the miracle of all miracles. His daughter is, and you know, it was so funny, the first thing Jesus said was, hey, go get her something to eat.
Yeah.
Go get her something to eat.
Pentecost.
Yeah, that's what I said. My daughter Stacy, she was 11 years old when she died, and I was in that very predicament that them parents were in. And I was cleaning my bedroom the other day, and it was, I forgot that she even drew this picture. I'll have to bring it tonight, or I'll show you when you come over today. But she drew a picture. She was 11 years old, and it shows a little girl on the hospital bed. And it's got angels, and it's got Jesus at the feet of her. And when Stacy died, Dr. Brew and Dr. Hensley pronounced her legally dead. And I'll never forget it. And
you never will.
No. And they told us not to worry, that the doctors can't do any more, that to get our funeral arrangements made. And they called the coroner and everything. And I said, well, you don't have to believe everything you hear. And like you said, it was weird because it was Dr. Hensley in the room. It was Dr. Brew, me, Tim, and Tim's mom, and Sister Pat. There were six of us. And for some odd reason, Brother Pat, I looked at Sister Pat and I said, do you have faith that God can raise the dead? And she just looked at me. She goes, well, yes, I do. And I looked at my mother-in-law and I said, do you have faith that God can raise the dead? And she goes, I don't know. I mean, she was flipping out just the same as Tim was. And of course, I was flipping out too, but I knew that we had to get a hold of God right then and there. And she goes, I don't know. And I said, then leave, because I don't want your faith wavering mine, because I know what my God can do. And I asked him the same question. I said, do you believe that God can raise the dead? And he goes, I don't know. I said, you leave. I don't want your faith wavering mine. And I looked at Dr. Hensley and Dr. Brew. And they was, I mean, their eyes was this big, and Dr. Priest said, yeah, you know, and he stood there, and the Lord told me to go over, and Stacy was laying on the bed, and I went to the bottom of her bed, and I laid my body over her body, because, I mean, I was devastated.
Sure.
I was screaming and everything, and I said, Lord, you can't do this. You cannot do this. And I heard him in a voice say, you praise me in good times, and you praise me in bad. And I said, Lord, it can't get any worse. My daughter's laying here. They just told me she's dead. It can't get any worse than this. And he goes, you praise me in good times and bad. And when I was laying over her, Sister Jennifer, I felt her spirit leave her body. And it hit me. And I cried out. I said, okay, God, okay, I'll praise you. And he goes, I mean, I want you to praise me. And I said, Lord, I don't understand. And I was a new baby. I mean, I hadn't been in this walk probably 5 or 6 years. And I said, what is it, Lord, you want me to do? And he said, I'll never forget it. He said, I want you to lift your hands, and I want you to praise me right here. And I did. I stood there, and I raised my hands. And the Holy Ghost came on me, and I was speaking in tongues. Before I knew it, I was outside of the hospital room, the doctor's room. And I was walking down the hallways, Brother Pat. And I was just speaking in tongues and just crying. I said, Lord, okay, my daughter's dead, but I'll praise you. And the whole time I was out walking the hallways and praising him at the doctor's office, the Lord gave Stacy back. He put her back in her body. And she was fighting. When she came up, she's going like this. And they go, what? What? I mean, they was flipping out. And of course, I couldn't do anything but praise him, because that's all he put me to do. Hey, she's back. And Stacy was mumbling. You know, she was doing this. And they said, what? And Sister Pat got down there by her ear, and this is what she said. She said, I am a blood-bought child of the King.
Oh,
the doctor goes, what does that mean?
Oh, God.
I am a blood-bought child of the King. And that doctor looked at me and he goes, she's not out of the woods.
And
I said, you know what? I said, God don't bring you halfway.
No.
And they said, well, we're taking her out of here and we're going to ship her to Riley. I said, you do whatever you think you got to do, because I know my God's here and she's just fine. I knew. Without a shadow of a doubt, they got this very day. They put a lifeline water because of the weather. So they brought this special paramedic unit. Sorry, I didn't mean to take all your
time. Go.
But they brought this special unit and they put her in it. And that is like an ambulance. It's pretty. It's an ambulance on wheels is what it is. I mean, a lifeline on wheels. And when they put her in there, I'll tell you how the devil is. When God's blessing you, he wants to mess it up. And when they shut them doors, Brother Pat, I heard to Satan. Well, let me back up first. 2 years before that, I prayed and asked God for a miracle. I said, Lord, I want to be a believer, and I want to be a Christian. And I said, how can I tell Brother Bobby that you raised the dead if I've never seen it?
Right.
And the Lord would tell me. I would hear him say, be careful what you ask for.
That's right.
And I prayed that prayer, guys, for 2 years. I prayed that prayer. Guess what? God allowed me to see the dead raised, but I didn't know it was going to be my 11-year-old. Uh-huh. You know? But when they shut them hospital and that ambulance door, I heard Satan say, yep, she's going to die. You won't see her again. And I said, Satan, I rebuke you right now in the name of Jesus, because you don't have it to hold her, my daughter. My daughter had received the Holy Ghost at 3 years old, and she belongs to God. If you take her now, then she's going to go to heaven. I'm not going to worry about it because my God gave me a promise. And you know when he said he gave me a promise? You know when you said that? Well, get this. We get up to the hospital. We get up right in. The first thing they do, they said she's on the seventh floor. And we get up there, and there's the chaplain standing there and the doctors. And they said, we need to take you in this room. And you know what that room is? The tank. And she died. And I looked at him. I said, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. And they looked at me. And they said, well, she must be distraught. That's why they kept saying, well, you're just distraught, honey, we know. But your daughter's not going to make it. And I said, well, I know my daughter's going to make it, because on the way there, Tim and Charity thought I was going crazy, because on the way there in the car, I kept seeing neon signs along the highway. Them big old bulletin boards, they were neon signs. They were bright pink and bright purple. And they say, your answer's on the way, your promise is on the way. I say all this stuff, and I touch him. I said, did you see that sign? And he goes, what sign? I said, it says, my promise is on the way. It's going to be all right. And he goes, it's okay, honey. And he told Charity, he said, Charity, just hold her. Ask Charity. Tim can tell you. He goes, she's all right, Georgia. You're going to flip out on me. I said, I'm okay. God's okay. He's going to take care of her. I said, it's all right. Well, when we got at the hospital, they took me in this room. And I said, I rebuke you. Kenny Richardson was there. I don't know if he told you this or not. But Kenny Richardson was there. And he said, Sis Georgia, he said, that girl's got to work. He said, because the devil sure fighting her. He got up there and they said, well, she won't make it. And said, she didn't make it. And I said, well, you're a liar. I don't believe your report. They already pronounced her dead once. You're not doing it again. I rebuke you. And so we went to the room, and I'll never forget it. I got pictures. I can bring pictures tonight if you guys like to see them. She was hooked up to life support. Well, when I walked in, I just grieved my heart.
Yeah.
I said, Lord, you don't do something halfway.
Yeah.
You don't do something halfway. And I said, I don't know why they got these machines on her, but God, you do. And she had these little tubes all in her nose and her mouth and stuff, and they had her all tied down on with these things. And me and her daddy walked in the room. She had big old tears running down her jaw, face. And she said, like that. And she made Tim get on one side and me on the other side. And she held her hands. And through them tubes, she said, if I die, Mommy, don't lose your faith in God. Promise you will be true. And this is a baby on life support. Life support. She's telling us that. And then Tim just broke down, and we just found beside her bed, and we was just falling. And I said, Lord, I said, you don't bring her halfway for no reason at all. And I said, Lord, I'm going to keep my faith. I'm going to keep my faith. And then they left her on out for 3 days, and then they finally took her off the life support, and they looked at me, and they said, okay, she's through this. And what she had was chickenpox syndrome. It's a fluid on the back of the brain. And they never make it out without Brother Pat. Or if they do, they're paraplegics or bedridden. And he said, now, okay, you got your daughter. She's going to be alive, but she'll never talk. She'll never walk. She'll never do anything. She'll be a vegetable laying there. Said, you had your way. God, your God brought her back. But you'll have to take care of her the rest of the way. And Stacy's looking at me like this. And I said, you know what? I said, I'll tell you like I told the devil all the way through this. God don't do things halfway. Stacy looked at me. She said, Mommy, I want to get up and walk. And then doctors have big old eyes. They said, girl, did you get my nurse? You never walk again. And she said, I'm going to walk. She said, I'm going to walk. And they said, No, you can't walk. And Tim said, good morning, please let me walk. Please let me walk. And I said, okay. I said, we'll set her up. We set her up on the side of the bed. And, you know, she had the foot on the back of her brain, so it made her wobbly. And we stood her up, and she stood up. And when we let go over, she went, whoop, fell out of the bed. And I said, stay, she sure? She said, yes, Mommy, I want up. And I said, okay. So we got her up again. And she, whoop, she fell back on the bed. Now, in this walk, you got to be persistent. Not only was me and her mom persistent in prayer, but she was persistent to show the devil.
Yeah.
That, you know, she had
determination.
I told her she was a blood-bought child of King, so
absolutely,
she knew all of them. So she said, stand me up again, Mom, and stand her up again. And she, we didn't let go this time. We just held her on charity. And you won't believe this, but this is what she did, right? She stood her up, and she went, Jesus. And I looked at her, and she goes, Jesus.
Oh, praise God.
See why we love crazy?
Jesus. And every time she would take a step, she would say Jesus. And before we walked out of Riley Hospital, they know Sexy Acres up there. They had her running down the aisles in front of people and said, this is a miracle. This is a miracle. That story just touches me every time because I know what that mother
her story
went through.
Because you know. And I want to read this and I'll close. And Brother Ronnie quoted Job earlier, and when his wife was saying, and his response to her was, but he said unto her, thou speakest as one of the foolish women speaketh. Why? Shall we receive good at the hand of God, and shall we not receive evil? It is in all this did not Job sin with his lips. It doesn't matter if it's good times or bad times.
Yeah.
When God was telling you, praise me, praise me, praise me, no matter what. You have to praise through the good times. You have to praise through the bad times. You have to give him honor and glory continuously. You can't take him out and put him on a shelf and say, oh, whenever I need you, God, I'll come back and pick you up. That's not how God works. You want God to work in your life? You've got to consistently, continually, persistently, with determination, Jesus, 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 Jesus. No matter what's in front of you, just like the woman with the issue of blood, you got to push your way through, push your way through, push your way through, because the enemy is going to throw everything against you to try to make
you
stop.
Right.
After the first five people stepped on her fingers, she could have said, oh, well, it's not working. But she did not. She went ahead and she pushed forward and she pushed forward and she pushed forward. No matter even it seemed impossible. Do you understand? She could have walked away, but she did not. She did not walk away.
The doctors told her that she would have epilepsy seizures and the different things, and they tried to put her on venobarbital and different things. And before she'd take her medicine, she would pray over it. She said, now, Jesus, I know you healed me. You have to show the doctors. And as soon as that venobarbital or dilate got in her system, she had to throw it back up. So they had to do the EKGs and the EGGs and all that. Oh, well, we know there's brain damage. We just got to find it. So they ran all these expensive tests and they couldn't find anything. But what the most amazing thing was, and I know it was confirmation for me, but the whole time that they was running her through these tests and stuff, there was neon signs. Now, Stacey will tell you this. All over Riley Hospital, it says, the Lord is your deliverer. He is your healer. By your stripes, he's healed. Everywhere all over that hospital, these neon purple, green, orange signs were all over that hospital. And every time me and Stacey would see them, matter of fact, the neon green, because we seen so many, that's our favorite color, the neon green. That's our little thing was these signs. But it was amazing. The doctors was determined to find something wrong with this child, and there was nothing wrong. The Lord completely healed her. They said that she was gone so long that she had to have brain damage. But,
I understand. Nope. I've been told that myself. I've been told, not for me, but for one of my children. There's no hope.
Yep.
She's gone. There's nothing we can do. And I said, oh no, it's not happening.
Yeah, I know.
And I mean, you just get a hold of God and you get a hold of God, and they say, but it's going to be permanent. And it's like, oh no, I'm believing God. I'm trusting God. I will not accept anything else. I will not. And when you stand, God says, I'll honor your faith. I will honor your faith. He honored Job's faith. No matter what came against him, he lost his possessions. He lost his family. He was losing his physical body. Even his best friends and his wife say, why don't you curse God and die? And he's like, listen, in good times and in bad times, I want to serve God no matter what. The woman had tried everything she could try. The only thing else was God, and so she knew, I have to get to him. Jairus did not lose his faith. He said, okay, I've came this far, I'm going a little farther. And even at the ridicule of his family and friends, he said, I'm still trusting God. Don't let that root of bitterness get in your heart and overshadow your visions that you can't see God anymore. You've got to let that Holy Ghost come in and tear down that bitterness, tear down any doubt. Push it all aside and put your eyes set on God, because he is our deliverer. He is our hope. He is our everything. Oh, I love him today. I love him.
Today, I know they are. I know there's some here that a lot of negativity has come your way. But God has got purpose in all that happens.
Amen.
He's going to work his will. And you're going to have a testimony like this girl had. She couldn't stop giving that testimony if she wanted to. I mean, that thing has kept her going all these years. I can tell you, when my boy had spinal meningitis, they said he would be a cripple, and he would be this, and he would be that. He's getting ready to retire from the post office, and he worked from the post office all these years, and bought him a bit. And the biggest problem he's had is his own alcoholism and stuff that he had to go through. They said, he'll never make it. I said, well, we got a God in heaven. He said, yeah. And you're going to be tried. You're going to be tested. You're going to go. Don't resent it when you go through these things. I don't want to take a lot of time because I know we're running late. But, you know, I've been prayed for a lot in the last several months. I got sick in the last of December. And sometime in February, I started getting better. And I thought I was on my way back. And all of a sudden, that germ came up again. First of all, it was a strep throat, strep germ. And then it turned back into pneumonia again. My lungs was full again. I went through all this thing. I'll write you a book sometime about what I've been through. It's been a most terrible time of my life, and I've never hardly had any sickness in my life.
And
it's true.
He's complained more this time than
it's awful. And I feel bad told days. I said, Lord, forgive me for complaining. I'm not a complaining person. I learned to work with seven little kids, and worked to sick, and went to work, worked a brickyard sick. I'm just not a complaining person. But I've done a lot of moaning and groaning. I don't know how to tell you, I have. And I've had a lot of prayer done for me, and I don't dispel any of that. I went down there last night strictly for Sister Julie, support her. And I've done that many times. I went to a tent revival in Clarksville, Tennessee to support her. I've been all over the country, and I just do those things. I think it's nice to look up and see your pastor. I don't know why, but her pastor don't seem to want to do that. But that don't matter to me. But anyhow, I sure dreaded going because through this medicine, I've had this bile come up in my throat, and it flavors my food. It flavors everything. They used to tell you, I went down to Cracker Barrel the other day to eat some beans, and they don't even taste like beans. They taste, and I love beans.
Why is that way now?
And I ate some greens. Beans and greens, that's what I love. Any kind of green, I love. And then greens taste like you poured tobacco juice on them.
Oh, my.
That's the flavor that's in my throat. Mm-hmm. I didn't eat it. I mean, and I'm licking. I'm drinking it. Normally, when I go, I drink the juice.
Amen.
And whatever's left of that green generator went fit to half. Because I love greens. I just do. But last night, and I really pushed myself to go. I dreaded that long evening. I know they go on and on and on, and they went on last night.
We got home at 10:45.
It's 10:45 when we got home. And I love Brother Spears. I love to be with him. I love the Spirit.
We started
of the
at 6.
Started six now. About time we started winding down, we took off again. And then somewhere in that service, a bunch of ministers just came up and just started praying for me. But I can't tell you what happened. But it's different today. It's totally different. I was sweeping out the back room back there because there's so much stuff in there. I haven't done anything like that. I've been walking all week. I've been trying to get my strength back. I know I'm weak. I cannot go. I couldn't hardly get my fire up in that car. So I got some work to do to get rehabilitated. And I'm going to do it. And I'm feeling so good about Jesus.
Amen.
And what he did for you there. And she told me that she had pneumonia. How many times did you have it?
I had it twice.
In 36 days in the hospital. And I spent 12 days total. And I'm the worst off guy. Well, she spent 36 days.
I was pregnant too.
And pregnant.
With Stacy.
I can't imagine going through that. I'm sorry you had to go through all this. But look what you've learned about God.
Oh, yes.
Nobody can ever convince you God didn't do that. You know he did. And some of you are needing a miracle just like that right now in your life. Yeah. A lot of negativity coming your way, and you know. But let me tell you something. God will prove himself to you in a big, 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 big way if you just trust him.
All right.
Hello. You want us to turn her back?
No, it's okay. Close your eyes. Well, I wanted to be special speaker for a really, really long time, and I had like all of these things like faith and fear and all of this, but I had a dream last night, so I'm going to talk about that. So last night, it was really, really weird. I'm just going to start off saying that, but it was in like the Bible times, and I was walking down this road, and then I turned into this like temple thing, and there was like God. He was like in so much pain. He was laying on this bed. And like people were like washing him down because there's like blood everywhere on his body, and he was just like shaking, and they're washing him down, and I started to cry, and I just turned around and I left. I don't know why, but yeah. So the next day I walked into my room, I guess, and where there was bunk beds, and I slept on the top and Jesus slept on the bottom, and I was laying down and I seen him come in and he laid down, and I go, Jesus, and he's like, yeah, Kim. I was like, will you stand up real quick? And he's like, yeah. So he stood up, and I grabbed his arm, and I grabbed his hand, and I just felt his hand. The nails on his, like, the wounds, and I seen, like, his back and his arms, and it was still cut from where they whooped him, and, like, I seen, like, the like, crown of thorns mark where it was on his head, and I looked him in the eyes, and I seen so much pain in his eyes, and I said, Jesus, I said, I really love you. And he looked me right in the eyes, and with so much honesty, and even though his body was in so much pain, he said, Kim, I love you too. And like, I can't get over that. He's like, Kim, he's like, I did this for you. And I was like, wow. And I like woke up crying, you know, just to think that the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords and would think that he did it for me was like so crazy, like. And, like, because he loved me so much.
Amen.
And, I don't know, like, that's what I kind of got was love. And I know that a lot of people talk about God's love a lot. But I hope, like, the simple truth is that people want to add to God more than what there really is. Uh-huh. His heart is love. He loves us, like, because we're his children.
That's right.
And a lot of people like to overcomplicate stuff by saying, well, you know, God does love us, but he only loves you if you wear skirts or if you have long hair. Like, I'm sorry to bust your bubble, but if God loved you, if God can look at you and die on the cross, even though we're sinners in our foolish ways, like, I'm pretty sure that God can love us even if we're wearing a skirt or not wearing a skirt, you know. Like, if he can love us in sin, he can love us when we wear pants. And, like, that's just how I feel. That's what I got out of this. And like, I don't know, like, a lot of people just want to overcomplicate stuff so much to the, like, the simple truth.
That's right.
Like, it's, like, maybe they think that it's too easy to understand that. Or, like, maybe it's too cliche.
Yeah.
People say that a lot.
Right.
But, yeah, like, he loves us. And I truly know without a doubt in my heart that if you give God everything, if you give God your heart, and if you really like be humble to Him, He will do nothing but bless you. Amen. Simply because He died for you, and simply because He loves you, and simply because no matter what the devil tells you, and no matter what people tell you, in the end, you were worth it.
Yeah.
And in the end, He did it for you.
Amen.
For every single one of you. Like God told me that, Kim, I did it for you, but God is also saying to you right now,
sure,
to me right now, that he did it for every single person in this room right now.
Amen.
Because, simply because He loves you.
Amen.
That's all I have.
That's good.